Okay, like I was trying to say a second ago. I'm an idiot. So, there is a hidden mechanic in this game regarding loser and gutter. We're going to come to a head with that specific mechanic in a moment. I really love it. I love that it allows you to kind of dictate the story, but the game doesn't let you know that you've done that. So I'll explain when we get to that, how exactly we can alter the course of events in regards to this operation.
And look at the balls.
Harnessing the power of Pepsi bottles, the Albed plan to destroy Sin. Walker hates Pepsi. He's a Coke fan.
Curses! Ow! Ugh.
He really hates them, huh?
Chapu. He left the sword Walker gave him in Bisade. And he fought with an Albed Machina weapon instead.
That's got nothing to do with it. I just hate these sacrilegious contraptions.
Except it totally does. I have a lot of emotions all kind of build up back here. Well, none of the NPCs around here actually give us anything, so... screw them! Let's just power on through. They just give you military jargon. Talk about the oncoming operation. We have a boss fight to get to. A really, really quite tough one for new players. This is the first time as a kid that I got stuck on the game. Like, had to go back and grind and... you know, reassess myself a bit to get through this next boss fight.
Why do you have to grind?
Just because this next boss, I couldn't figure out the method of beating it. I didn't realise what I was supposed to do. Like, with Final Fantasy games, because I've played so many of them, my default is to just mash attack, 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 use a magic spell if you absolutely need to. This game, because it's turn-based, and because there's a lot to the combat, it's a lot more technical. You can't just attack everything and win.
Won't work anyway.
That's a pretty easy way of losing the game,
don't
in fact.
Well, you can attack everything and win, but it's just campaign. Like, where do you need to attack?
Exactly.
But the Crusaders and the Albed, they're doing their best to defeat Sin. They want to rid Spira of Sin forever. And that's just what we want too, isn't it? Isn't it?
All right. But I still think Mac and I are bad news. They're forbidden for a reason.
No, we don't know the reason.
There you are. Good point, you know. Good point, well made, but what could you do?
Maester Keenock too?
Yes. Please, hurry, my lady.
I think Waka might be a tad unreasonable when it comes to following the scriptures of Yevon. I don't know, it's just a hunch regarding his character. A little something I may have picked up about him. Cool story, bros. Yeah, I'm pretty sure none of these NPCs have anything for us. Kind of screwed up that you're letting a little kid fight there, but there you go. That's just how the world is. Here's an opportunity for game-breaking weapons! Weapons that you will use for most of the game because they're so good. First of all, you have the Avenger for Ject. What that does is it allows him to counterattack. Anytime he gets hit physically by an enemy, he gets a free hit back. Sometimes that'll win you battles on its own. On top of that, after I've sold a few useless items that I've accrued to get a bit of extra cash, because even with the discounts, I'm not doing that well for money right now. Couple more. There we go. The TKO. There is a weapon for Waka that can petrify enemies. In this game, if you petrify an enemy, like a normal random encounter enemy, it dies immediately.
Please check all your equipment.
You alright?
Of course not. I came here to fight Sin, but they stick me here.
If you want to prove yourself.
Huh?
First, you must complete the tasks you are given.
Or you could just ignore Auron and listen to me.
Exactly. Don't listen to the old man, he's a square. You should be out on the front lines.
It's not fair.
Get yourself out there, Gutter.
Do something.
Be a man.
If it means bending the rules.
Fight the giant monster whale dad. Forget I said dad. I didn't say dad. I'm bad at this. But anyway, by talking to him twice and telling him he should be out on the front lines, we've changed how the course of the game is going to pan out, or the course of the operation, in a really, really decisive fashion.
And you have to talk to him twice or it doesn't lock in.
Good to see you, Oren. 10 years, is it?
That's when Kinnock, one of the four maesters of Yevon. He leads the warrior monks, and also commands the crusaders.
The thing I love about Maester Kinnock here, you know, as if we didn't have enough popes running around in this game, the thing I love about him is that he clearly has a strong history with Oren as a character. That's one of his defining traits. And I kind of love that, because Oren, for every other character, is this mystical, historical, famous figure. So to have a character who's just on normal terms with him, there's something really charming about that. For as little as you see of it, you can tell it's there.
I like how he just said, oh, they're just gonna fail anyway.
Yeah, and he had an evil little cherub face as he said it.
That Kinnock a maester? I heard that, Oren. A lot has happened the last 10 years. What were you doing and where? Fulfilling a promise I made to a friend. I still am. Just tell me one thing. Have you seen Xanarkand?
I kinda think we don't belong here.
It is time at last. We must tell the Elbed waiting outside to begin the operation at once. The fiends may break through. This place is not safe. Make sure you're prepared to defend yourselves. Tell me when you're ready.
Tell me when you're ready to take on a ridiculously tough boss fight for new players. A boss fight where you have to fight very specifically or you are going to get completely murdered. The first really challenging fight, I will contend. I'd say the second one is Evre when we get to that, because loads of people I know struggled with Evre.
Go to Yuna.
I'm a little nervous.
Well, good advice, Oren. You dumb old man. She's a little nervous, by the way. I guess you wanted to know.
And if you didn't turn on the map...
Hmm?
If you didn't turn on the map, that would have just been confusing.
Oh, yeah. Like, you go to Yuna and, what? Now what? Okay, so here I am leveling up all my characters, making sure they're ready for this next fight. You know, because preparation is important with boss fights in this game. You always want to be prepared. Make sure your character is always in peak physical condition to take on the bosses. That we are, we're definitely ready. Let's take on this boss.
Please.
Will Sin come?
Sin always returns for its spawn. To make sure, we're going to encourage them to call out to it.
You won't have to. It'll come.
I remembered Oren telling me. Sin is my old man. Sin is Jekt.
So maybe I am the Sin Spawns. And then Titus was a Sin Spawn. Off the bat, our plan is kind of falling apart because the Sin Spawn we had locked up is just kind of broken out. Good cage, guys. Well done. Here is a Sin Spawn.
Sin's children just merged together.
Well, yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah, because the head is that little bug we saw earlier. Yeah. Yeah. By the way, you may have noticed something. For all I was talking about earlier about preparing the characters, I forgot to hit the save point and heal everybody. Which is why all my characters are nowhere near as strong as they should be. Why I'm kind of flailing about right now, trying to get my bearings with things. I am really bad at forgetting to save slash heal in this game.
No, you're really good at forgetting to...
Yeah, I'm good at forgetting to... I'm good at forgetting to do that. I'm bad for forgetting to do that. Anyways, the key to beating this boss is to start off by exclusively attacking its head. If you don't focus attacks on the head and try to just take out the body instead, the head will start murdering you with poison attacks, which are really, really unfun to deal with. So, yeah, important thing is just to keep wailing on them. And try not to get killed as you're doing so. Waka and Lulu are kind of important for this first half of the fight. Just to take down that head. But anyways, a couple of null shocks as well. Definitely don't go amiss, because this guy likes using thunder magic. Something you'll notice about this Sin Spawn and the one we defeated way earlier in the game, right at the beginning of the game in fact, is they love using Demi. That is because Sin's main power, his main offensive ability, is Gravager, or gravity magic. So the Spawn have a slightly weaker version of it in the form of Demi, a standard one quarter of your health disappears gravity spell. Anyways, a few more hits on that big ugly head. And anytime it jiggles like that, that is your key to start attacking at it, to take it down immediately. Because if you don't, it's going to puke vomit on you, and you're going to die.
A good way to grind is to attack the arms.
Yeah,
that's
something you brought up, actually. Like, if you're at a good enough point in the game where this boss isn't a threat to you, you can just keep killing its two arms there. They regenerate every few turns, and like you say, they give you AP. And AP definitely doesn't go unwelcomed. Essentially just helps you level up way quicker. More electrocutions of the head. More healing of the Wakas. And now that Yuna's overdrive bar is nice and full, we can forget about that stupid head now, because now we're just going to nuke your entire body. Prepare to get nuked. Did we see Doge's overdrive yet? Have we shown that off?
I don't remember.
We're going to. If we didn't before, we're going to now. Because it's great. As it is in every Final Fantasy, we see it. So first of all, we'll bring in Bird. We'll do Bird's overdrive. Energy Blast, of course. Get wrecked. There goes most of your body. The head and the arms. The cool thing about the head is once it's dead, it stays dead. It doesn't regenerate like the arms do. That's something I didn't figure out as a kid. And so I was really, really paranoid about that head. Hated it.
Doesn't it say it in the help?
It says it in the scan or in the sensor description, but I rarely put sensor on my characters. I kind of played this like older Final Fantasies where I wanted to learn by doing, but that did make things a lot harder. It is very helpful having the game basically tell you how to play it. Anyways, let's get that power break on. I should have done that earlier because he has been battering me a little bit. That's never fun to deal with. Give him a couple of hits. And here comes Doge! Rawr. Hellfire. The thing I love most about this move is just how overkill it looks. It looks absurd, especially with giant enemies who get caught up in the air by the hellfire. Then caught in an orb of fire.
That doesn't look done. Just
it just looks so weird. There. And then it's like, yeah, let's just give you a little salt in the wounds. For which I mean rock in the face. But yeah, this is the first boss that has just a ridiculous amount of health as well. It has like 12,000 health? So, even using your Aeon's overdrives liberally isn't enough to beat this guy. It's the first example of that happening in this game. So, a couple of cheers and just a couple of batterings. That's the way we do. That's how we do. That's how we beat the rest of this fight. What are your thoughts on Sinspawn Gui? Sinspawn Gui? What are your thoughts on this boss?
I think it's the most fun boss in the game.
The most fun in the game?
Yeah.
It's good. I like that there are so many different factors that you have to take into account as you're playing it. There are some bosses later that are more memorable to me. Some really stand out as being super fun.
It's the first hard boss.
Yeah, definitely. I'm glad that you agree with me on that and that I'm not proving myself to be a scrub by saying that. When you were quiet on that one earlier, I thought you were quietly thinking to yourself that I'm a loser who can't beat bosses good.
You are kind of a loser for thinking it was difficult.
I was a kid! I was like 10 years old! Anyways, this cutscene is rad. For all the lame introductory cutscenes we've dealt with in the last two parts, this is just hardcore. Possibly one of my favourite moments in the whole game.
Bottle caps.
So, yeah, let's just use Coke / Pepsi bottles on him. A little bit of Nuka-Cola right in your face.
That's what happens when you mix Mentos with...
Exactly. Coke. That's the Albed's forbidden machina is Coke and Mentos, actually. That's all it really is. Coincidentally, one of Sin's biggest weaknesses.
It's like holy water.
Yeah. Holy Coke.
Look out!
Oh, I love that. It looks so grotesque in such a good way. And then you get this! Jesus! Oh my god! How are we contending to fight that with swords? What's wrong with us? Crusaders, what was your actual plan? Like, it can evaporate you by being near you. Jesus Christ. Oh, man. And here it is. First battle with Seymour in the party. He's such a good character. And he's really tough. Oh, also Aura's here, I guess. Whatever. The appeal is gone, Aura. No one cares anymore.
Stand back, Lady Yuna.
Yes.
So, on top of being a great boss fight that really demonstrates how strong of a character Seymour is, this is the first time you hear the second boss theme. I love this music. Because the music we've had... The normal boss music in this game, I actually think it's kind of naff. It's a bit too miserable and not very energetic. This one relatively gets you way more pumped when it really kicks into it. Like, just loads of build up, and then it kind of breaks down a little bit later on. So as you can see, because we were beating him up earlier, this thing is weakened quite heavily. Seymour's overpowered magic does help, though. And if you really want to in this fight, because as you can see, Seymour does have like a ridiculous amount of health and MP. If you want to let Seymour get beaten up quite a lot, just to show off his overdrive at this point in the game, he has a move called Requiem, and it turns the screen black, and then the enemy starts like pulsing red, and then they explode.
And you can mimic that move later on in the game.
Oh, really? How?
You can mix things.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that. I didn't know you could make Requiem happen. We're gonna have to do that. Cool. Anyways, for this fight, Yuna is most definitely just your allocated healer. Seymour's gonna be dishing out that magic-y justice. Right in his face. And Auron can, beat up the arms, I guess. Aura doesn't really need to be here, he's just there as a just-in-case. But yeah, Seymour could solo this thing if he wanted to, he really could.
Auron's just good for getting Yuna right here.
Auron is your AP grinder guy. Although Seymour can do that as well, with his magic, so yeah. Okay, there's not much left to this boss now. Again, the fact that Sin Spawn are technically Jet's or Tidus' brothers that's something that's just going to stick in my head now because I can't really unthink that thought. It's kind of changed how I look at these fights in general. But there we go. That's the end of Sin Spawn Gui. He just kind of dissolves into nothing. In fact, all the Sin Spawn do that, and I kind of like that. Good bit of consistency there. And lots of leveling up! Yeah! All the levels. I could have mashed the button to play through that quickly, but it's more satisfying to let it just rack up.
The others!
Anyways, if that scene evaporating the people scene wasn't cool enough, let's see what happens when you apply laser beams to Sin's face. Oh my god, this scene is the best. Look how cool that looks. Like, wow.
This was on PS2.
Yeah, and it looks just as good on the PS2. That, like, this scene blew my mind as a kid. Like, oh my god. See, the thing with 13, oh my god, just get screwed. Down you go. I like to imagine that bit of burning debris is actually the people, are the people falling out of it. But Final Fantasy 13, you get big amazing set pieces all the way through the game, really explosive scenes, but it comes so often that it stops being interesting or impressive.
Yeah, it's not memorable.
Yeah, that moment in this game is so standout, and I love it. Because it is the perfect indicator of just how screwed we are, of how much of an uphill battle this is. In fact, I did a little bit of research, and from this game's, like, conception, from the very beginning stages, the whole game was supposed to be themed about the fact that you have one big, unstoppable enemy, and the whole world is banding against it, and
this
I kind of love that.
This pause is really long.
It is, yeah.
I just realised that.
He's kind of grunting in pain, but yeah. Lots of dead people now. And if you really want something really sad, if you want to just really upset yourself, a good thing to do here is go talk to all those NPCs who have just been murdered. And yeah, some of the comments made are really just ungodly morbid. So, on that note, let's see how this trooper's doing. How you doing, bud? Slightly warm, no sign of breathing. Okay, how about you? Staring at the sky, lifeless. Reclining, breathless.
I like to think that he's actually saying this.
He's giving his own little coroner report for every person he encounters here. Rip in peace. But remember earlier I was saying there was a hidden mechanic? If you just play through the game normally, Luzu dies and Gutter has a panic attack about it and decides to go back to Perseid. If you encourage him to go to the front lines, he dies. Either Luzu or Gutter die in this game. And you, the player, once you know about it, pretty much decide which one has to die. You can't save both of them. One of them will die. And that's really, really horrible. But, you know, I feel like in this LP we had to choose Gutter because a lot of people don't actually know about that.
Could have let Luzu die and just, like... Get revenge.
That's just it. Whichever one dies, it kind of has a different impact on the plot. If Luzu dies, it feels like retribution for Chapu, for him inadvertently killing Chapu.
But even this is like revenge for killing.
But yeah, this is... Now he's now in the same position as Waka, where someone he clearly loved, someone that super close to him, is now gone from his life. And now we've got to deal with Luzu's emotional breakdown, which will be coming shortly. And I feel it's more powerful as well. I pretty much always go for Gutter death. Sorry, Gutter.
But I must do something!
You can't!
Alright, dick. He could have been nice about it. This is another one of those points in the game where you get close to Sin, and through a weird mix of both Toxin and the psychic connection between Inject and Inject, the game just gets super trippy and weird. It's one of those moments, in case you were missing these guys.
I have no idea what I was thinking when I ran after Sin that day. Before I knew what I was doing, there I was, chasing him down like a thief at market. Maybe I was angry. Maybe I wanted to go home. I kept thinking of Xanarkand and my old man.
Playable flashback. I say playable in that you can run around and not really do anything while the flashback plays, but you know, it's there. Okay, so this place we're at right now, you actually do get a chance to visit this place way, way, way later in the game. I thought this was just entirely, you know, hallucinogenic, but it does actually have some bearing in reality, which is kind of weird. Everything about Sin is actually kind of weird. Like, when you read up about Sin, in terms of his, like, character documents and all that, like, stuff the developers created, he's a really, really weird creature. Like, he is just a giant mass of, like, living death. And when he dies, like, the mass dissipates but reforms itself.
Yeah, because it's always the same structure.
Yeah, yeah.
What?
They say you don't practice anymore, that you're gonna retire.
Let them talk. I'm still the best.
They say you're no good because you drink all the time.
I can quit drinking whenever I want.
Then do it now.
What did you say?
You just said you can't.
Tomorrow, maybe.
Why not today?
Why do today what you can leave for tomorrow? There he goes again, crying.
I feel like this is the only video game where you can come into contact with a giant murderous space whale and have a little bit of
have a little insight into its
alcoholic tendencies.
Somewhere. Or maybe it was just Sin's toxin playing tricks on my mind.
Well, that was an adventure. Operation Meehan. 0 out of 10, would not operate again. Kinda went badly. It kinda went worse than anything we've pretty much experienced at all in this game.
People die and Yuna dances. When will she stop dancing? When will it stop?
Gotta kill Sin. She stops dancing.
Yeah. Sin is gone. Her choreography is just the worst. Can't be dealing with that.
I see you're still here.
Oh, hey, Oren.
Huh?
Many stories ended here today. But yours goes on, I see.
What?
Or loads of people just died. Can you stop being a cryptic idiot for one moment, please? Can you just pay your respects like a decent human being? Maybe? Oren? Just saying!
A swift retreat. Satisfied?
What do you mean?
Those who turned from Yevon died, while the faithful live on.
The past 10 years have changed you, I see.
You do not look so well. But now, more than ever, you must be the people's strength, their confidence. Anyone else would be expected to show their sorrow.
Like Waka there, for instance.
But you are a summoner. You are Spira's hope. Until Sin is defeated, you must not relent. Do you understand?
So please, yes. Try laughing out loud. Ha 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 ha! That's how I imagine Seymour laughs. It's my headcanon.
Take me as your pillar of strength. As Unaleska had her Lord Zeon.
If you know what I mean. About Chikawowow. This may be the worst time for me to be flirting with you. I'm just gonna go, bye. This was a terrible idea. Bye, Seymour.
Sin is checked.
Yeah. For a while there, I thought I could feel him. But that doesn't mean I believe you.
Sin is checked. He came here for you.
So he killed all those people just for a chance to see me?
That's what Sin does. He wanted to show that to you. Do you know why?
How am I supposed to know?
So you would kill him. As long as he is Sin, Jekt will keep killing. He wants you to stop him.
So you wouldn't think it. Kidding. But Sin is a tragic villain. Anyway. Like, yeah. Sin doesn't want to be doing what it's doing. It just it's kind of being forced to.
You're the one running.
So yeah.
He's kind of like the hero as well.
Would you say that? Would you go that far? I wouldn't go so far as to say this giant apocalyptic death whale is the hero. Well, that may be pushing it.
He wants to stop himself.
From doing the thing that he is doing that is exclusively bad and the main cause of all sorrow in this world. I mean, I'm sure Hitler had second thoughts, but those second thoughts does not a hero make, you know? I'm just saying. Maybe not the best analogy in the world, but I'm just saying. Hey, Shalinda, give us some healing, please.
Are you all right? Hold still.
Whew, all healed up. Now I guess I'm ready for the boss fight. Oh wait, yeah, cool.
I just touched a save sphere. I don't need your healing.
Well, it's just nice. I just wanted to interact with her. She's a nice lady. I want her to feel like she's helping.
Could have just told her to keep up the good work.
Yeah.
Equally as good.
Look, if I get a free heal, I get a free heal. Whatevs.
Better move Walker off the screen.
Hmm.
In dark times, she must be. She must shine bright.
Huh?
Oh, hey Kimari, you talk now. Dark times. And you're also voiced by John DiMaggio. We should help her. This is why Kimari and Walker never talk to each other.
She tries harder. Do not frown.
Don't worry, be happy.
Kimari, try too.
Smile, let me see. Sad.
Now try laughing out loud.